Planning Commission meeting to order. It's February, no, it's March 6, 2019. And start off the agenda, we'll get up and say Pledge Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, we have the next item on the list is a motion to approve the agenda for tonight.
Point of order, Mr. Chair. On the agenda, I would like to ask the question of why we don't have the open forum listed on this.
Good question.
Mr. Chair, I think it was just an oversight with the person putting together the agenda, and somehow it was removed. But we'll put it back into the agenda, into the numbering system. And in this case, you would just add between 7 and 8 for 7A, and you can have a public open forum.
Any other questions?
Nope.
Anybody want to make a motion then on the?
I would make the motion that we would amend the Planning Commission meeting agenda for 3-6-19 to include 7A public open forum.
Would it be 8A? Or no, I'm
7A.
Sorry. 7A, I'm sorry. Second?
Okay. We'll call to a vote. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Ayes have it. They win. So next thing on the agenda is a discussion with Lloyd Rabine, concept on subdivision plan. And if I'm right, you want us to, Elizabeth, to go down to these tables here?
You know, sometimes it's easier to see all the plans. I know the surveyor has the bigger plans. This is just a concept plan, so if you want a discussion with them at the table so they can point out things, we can certainly move to the horseshoe tables.
Like to do that?
Yes,
please. That's what you'd like to do.
Let's go down there. A horseshoe table.
Actually, this is probably the second time I've met with Lloyd. Just talking about a concept plan because at this point he would like to subdivide his land. He has a total of 15 acres. And so we talked about the different things and rules and regulations that surround the property. So there's a few things within the subdivision that we had to talk through. But I'll turn it over to
Okay.
So in this particular case, he's chosen that he would like to go down that route. And when you go down the PUD route, it allows you to vary certain standards. And we've seen this in other subdivisions that have come in where you look at the subdivision overall. Allows you to vary some requirements, but still meet the intent of the code. And so in this particular case, they would come in and they indicated that they would like the three lots and they would like to transfer. here tonight, just kind of, you know, I wanted to have an opportunity to kind of discuss about the vision, be able to answer your questions as members of the Planning Commission, as he is planning to bring this forward in the next few months. So it was a good forum to ask questions, look at the code, think about it before he actually submits. Although it's pretty far down the line as far as information. So the other thing that's on this one is a county road. They understand that they have to apply to another county to get access for driveway. And they understand it's a nice street water district. So they know that they have to do a what the delineation, and they know they have to get access to some areas that's different, which I think they're the way to snow belt, how about that? It might be a long wait this year. So really, this is your opportunity for them to ask them questions and have a dialogue about what you think about the subdivision. Really, there's no decisions being made tonight. It's really more about discussion.
Can you use the example of you went from 10 and 5 in prior preserve? So there was no houses there existing already. So it was easier to do that along those lines because it's open and there's nobody living there. This is quite dense here. So, you know, that I understand your example. So we would
will you be able to
set that?
The building's not going to set.
Okay.
So what
is the average lot size in that building? Here?
Yeah. Yeah. one variance for the two variances for each lot.
Because they're applying for the PUD, they don't have to apply for any variances. Because the PUD, the way it operates, it allows you to vary certain requirements. And in this case, it will allow you the variation of road frontage. So just by agreeing, the way a planning development works is you are allowed to vary certain circumstances in order to have this development. And in this case, he's going to be asking for a variance in, or a variation, not a variance, a variation in road frontage. And I think that's actually the verbiage in the code. It says that he's asking for a variation from the code requirement. And that's the whole point of
your place. Yeah, for those two lots.
was talking to you earlier. Boy, this used to be an address off the Kettle River, right? It used to have an address that was for the property, right?
Yeah, at one time.
Yeah. Yeah, not on the whole piece. I gather Birch Estates was there before you got there?
Yes.
Okay. And you bought the property. That's how you wanted to access it. 260 acres.
Yes.
Is this yours, Julie?
Yes.
It's
on the list, but it'll go to the top of the list now.
So, just the one variation is all
we need then? The one variation for all three lots.
Just the road frontage.
Road frontage. Okay. you're allowed to add the road frontage.
So you're allowed to add the 220 by 33 to the lot, which is 1.7 acres. So sometimes your lot will be 5 acres.
What does it have to do with right now?
The road frontage is included. But, you know, I mean, overall, you know, it's you know, our three lot subdivision, Floyd understands that you'll pay part of the dedication and for the two new lots. And in the city, we have part of the dedication of $1,525 for new lots. Existing lots of record. So for a subdivision application, they come in, they have their preliminary plat, don't have the wetland delineation. A delineation is always on the preliminary plat. And a preliminary plat, it shows driveway locations for a final plat. You will not have driveway locations. On a preliminary plat, it shows you a building path. It shows you septic sites. The septic sites will be shown also where you have an alternate review it as a staff with them and then staff along to the planning commission. So that's a fair amount of upfront work that they do. In this particular case, he's coming through concept. So if there's things that you want to add, this is the time you add, you know, those sorts of things where I think this is good or I think this is bad, or you can give opinions to them. We don't really have a whole lot of design standards for subdivisions. But again, it's an opportunity. Lloyd and I have talked about existing homes. So, say Lloyd had a huge accessory building because he had so much stuff that he needed a huge accessory building. I would explain to Lloyd that saying that, you know, for 5 acres, you only get X amount of square footage for your accessory building. And if you don't have it, you might have to take a few panels down and you may have to condense it. In this case, Lloyd doesn't have to take accessory buildings, so he doesn't have to worry about that. But in other subdivisions, when you have rather large buildings on large acreage, you do have to look at that, and then they either get, again, a variation in PUD, or they have to keep the size of presence of the new lots that they're creating. So we've had people in the past take down panels and realize that. Talked to Lloyd briefly about showing an alternate septic site. Even though it's existing on the record, you still have to show an alternate septic site. Now, say Lloyd didn't have one. We would require him to put him on if he had to move a property line to get it. Trying to think of all the things that we talked about that day. So basically, when they come in, we go over the, you know, a rather large checklist, make sure that documents are in order, and if there's any legal issues, we try to get them up front. In this case, I didn't see a site line easement or any of that kind of thing for consent. So we learn a lot of things the first time in, when they come in. They usually have a little bit of information on what the information I mean. We have checklists, we go through the checklist. And then we come to today. So we had a meeting, and we realized that we had some of these issues. And I said to Lloyd, well, like, you have an opportunity to go to the planning commission and do a concept kit plan review. And I said, lucky for you, I can put you on next week. I told them it never happens that way. But they were lucky enough that we had a meeting. And so there's always that option, but it's optional. So not every applicant wants to come through a concept review. And they want to skip that, and they just want to go direct to that. So we don't always have this opportunity. I have on occasion got people, give me feedback. Well, my neighbor got a notice, but I didn't get one. Well, unfortunately, that 350 line, it's just really a circle. And it's whatever property it is. And we don't always know which ones are going to hit. But we mail to who we're required to mail to. And in this particular case, I literally used to measure. The 350. Now we have a fancy computer that does it for us, and so it's much easier to do. So whatever properties they tell us, now that's who we now notice. So neighbors do get notified, but again, it's a limited amount of neighbors that get notified in that range. And then we have the public hearing. So in this particular case, a public hearing would be held. The same night, we have two public hearings. We have a public hearing for the preliminary plat, and we have a public hearing for the commission. And it's really at your discretion, Ron, whether you decide that you are going to combine the hearings or have individual hearings. And sometimes it's good to combine them, and other times it's not good to combine them. Reason being is if you have a preliminary plat and a conditional use permit for a use. There are two completely different things. Where in this case, the conditional use permit is for the subdivision, so your set of facts are going to be pretty close. But if you have a preliminary plat and the conditional use permit is for their auto-related business, the facts are completely different. And so when you're holding a public hearing, people are testifying on different things, and sometimes that's hard to follow. So it will be at your discretion as to when you combine the hearing for applications or when you vote them separately. Bill has told us either way is fine, you just have to know which facts are for which application. So after we held the public hearing, you'll have discussion, and then you make the recommendation. Every preliminary plat will have a planner. And in that center report, we'll have the finding staff and then conditions. Any planning commission member can amend any of the findings or any of the conditions. Or you can adopt them as it's your record. So it gives you a base. It doesn't mean that you can't amend it or you can't change it. Our previous planner gave us reports and they were addressed to you. And then he would sit at the meeting and he would amend them or change them, and then he would redo his report to the council. I don't know if we're still going to have that format, but that was the way he did it. So it just depends on who we or where we land in the plan. That's how people do it. But I guess what I'm saying is if you go out to the property and you look at the findings and you want to add one, you're able to do that. There's lots of stuff that goes the floodplain map and the wetland map are very close. You know what I mean? When you overlay them, and usually the boundary dummies are pretty close. But again, you can't build a floodplain, and you have to be 3 feet above the model for over granite. You have to be 2 feet above for a floodplain. So most times, also consistent with the septic system because that can be 12 inches of unstirred soil. So if, when you see the plat, you'll see the contours, which they're required to put on plat. You'll see it'll be 906, 908. If you're looking at 899, you're like, okay, you're probably in a wetland or close to it. Whoever you're hiring to do the delineation will tell you if you don't have protected wetlands, you don't need a letter from the DNR. They're going to tell you that right off because they're going to know. And then they're going to tell you if there's a water, you know what I mean, that if your wetlands lead to a waterway. And it's good to hear that it's a private ditch because as soon as I heard ditch, I'm like, oh, Army Corps is going to be in, but you said it was a private ditch, so I'm not quite sure where it leads to. So, I mean, that's something you just have to kind of, you know, look at the overall, where does the water go? And I think you told you said Howard Lake.
Yeah.
So they may have. Yeah, so they may have just some jurisdiction in there. But again, if you tell them it's a three lot subdivision, you're not going to impact the wetlands. I'm sure they'll you'll give you a letter that you're not impacting them. They don't have.
Your neighbors about this? Oh. I
watershed determines or verifies the line. So your delineator makes the line and then breaks the line to determine that is the line or it's not the line. And usually they'll attach some sort of a TEP panel, which is a TEP panel, it's called a technical evaluation panel. And it's a group of three, and they go out and they look at the plat, generally what the plat are pink, and they make sure that the line that the person who they
hires. Get quite an education working with several different wellness specialists and such on land, water management, wetland lines and such. And so it did give me a broad overview. And I will tell you, there's a lot of times that I'd be standing there and I'd be like, way in the woods, and I'd be like, okay, I can see it. But I had no fear. And I'm like, I don't know where you're going in there. How are they being in these weeds? I'd be like, okay, I'll make sure you come out.
I'll guard it over here.
Yeah. But again, it was interesting through that whole process. And then shortly thereafter, the legislature changed the rule. And the rule said that every member on the TEP panel had to have a legal weapons specialist. And so I lost my title. And so we have a joint powers agreement with Breakthrough Watershed District. And they serve as the technical person on the TEP panel for 7 or 4 months. So I still process all the paperwork. I just don't sit on the TEP panel. I do go along sometimes to just observe, but then I'll have to answer them. So we do have a buffer. It's a 16.5. So what I mean by that is you're 3 feet above the model soil. You have to bring your building pad up. Remember, I told you usually your wetland is at like 899 or so. In 16.5 feet, you can't bring the grade up. You can't bring the grade up. Otherwise, you'd fall out of your house. It generally doesn't work. You have to see the next sign. So there's no every 50 feet you have to put a sign. And we could talk about that, what a sign has to say, but usually it's like 3 or 4 points. And it's basically to put property owners on notice that it's a level of boundary, but you can't call it. Because we most of my time tend to really know. My mom works stuck. Drainage utilities might be, you have to put a 20-foot drainage utility down the road, and then it's 10 foot on each line, and then over what? So you don't have to sign the drainage utility easement, but you only have to sign the weapon.
possible approval?
Not yet, but...
See, I brought my darn phone again.
Oh, did you?
Now we open up to a public forum?
Yep.
So we're going to open up the meeting to a public forum. Does anybody have anything they'd like to say, state, make a comment? How great a job we did?
Yeah.
Pretty neat when you know everybody in the crowd. So, well, we'll close the open forum, and we'll go to City Administrator's Report.
I only have one item. The League of Minnesota Cities came out with a new Planning and Zoning 101 memo, so I printed them for you. It's probably a review for some. Others, there's some, I won't say new information, but it's well organized. They give you the pyramid chart on the back, which I thought it was really helpful for decision making. The League puts out some good materials, and what I like about their materials is they give you the statutes for reference, so you know where they're taking the information from. So I think it gives you a lot of information in pretty layman's language. So it's really more for your information.
Thank you. Next item is Planning Commissioner's Report. We have none. And a reminder, number 10, Jody, you're going to be at the next council meeting?
I will. I did have a question, though, on the Planning Commission report. When you went to the last city council meeting, did you have anything that you wanted to bring back to the Planning Commission?
No, not really. It just...
They discussed the IUP.
The IUP, yep.
Yeah, Pam was there with me.
That was nice, yeah.
They've decided that they're going to do a two-year minimum, it was a two-year minimum on a... Up to 2 years on the first one.
So maximum?
Maximum 2 years on the first IUP.
On home business?
Mm-hmm. That way they can decide, is it invisible, is it causing problems, giving Elizabeth a little bit more policing of the situation.
Right, give them a head start, yeah. I remember that.
So what did they say about people that aren't coming forward with the, you know, for an IUP that should be, that are presently doing business in the city? Is the city council going to enforce anything, or did they even talk about it?
Well, it kind of came up a little bit just because I'm not quite sure, but it was indicated that the two that were there were already operating, and there one was complaints, right?
Well, one Waldox was operating already. It's under the police.
Okay.
But I don't think the dog kennel was.
Yet. No, but we didn't really have, they didn't really give a...
None of the complaints had anything to do with the businesses. Right,
but there were complaints.
There were complaints.
There were complaints on the property, which, when we sent the CSO, brought to our attention other things were going on, and then they applied for the permit.
Then they came into compliance.
Well, I don't know if they're in compliance.
Well, they came in and did the first part. They came in for the first part, yeah.
Yes, they came in for the business permit.
Okay, so
I hadn't heard.
They didn't ask about getting some kind of teeth in the ordinance for accountability if we run into these issues, because, I mean, our ordinance is pretty vague on
I think what the council is, you know, we're looking at the checklist, and at this point, we're looking to tighten up the checklist and make a more defined application so they answer more questions in order to do that. And then the guidance was that it would be more of, to put the applicants on notice that more than likely you're going to get only 2 years the first time around, and then subsequent permits would be for a longer period of time if appropriate. As far as amending the ordinance, I don't know that we talked about individual items to amend the ordinance. I don't think we got that far in our, and although we have a list of things to look at, I don't know that there's anything in particular we were going to look at or study at this point.
I didn't remember hearing anything.
One thing I didn't mention is that I had an opportunity to talk to Hyla because at our last meeting we did have the incomplete letter. And so the next council workshop on April 3rd is going to, Hyla's going to come in, talk with the council on a workshop level, talking through the letter. The Friday before, she's going to have a full copy of the comprehensive plan with all of the changes, and she's going to identify all the changes. After she makes her presentation to the council, she'll take a coffee break and then come back and then talk to the Planning Commission and go through the same thing with the Planning Commission and then start to talk about policy issues and recommendations and such. I'm not sure whether we'll get through it, but again, it's an opportunity for us to work through that, and that's going to be on April 3rd. So at your next meeting, you do have a public hearing. It's Doug Dystra, who is looking for a conditional use permit at 13733 Lake Drive, which is an existing building. He's an internet business. He gets cars from California, refurbishes them, and then sells them online by appointment. And so you'll be looking at that conditional use permit.
That's 13733?
Yes.
Three.
A good memory.
Three, yeah.
I did the public hearing notice, so.
And what was his name, Doug?
Doug Dystra. Like D-Y-S-T-R-A. And that's at your March 20th meeting.
Okay. That's just one item on there?
One item for now.
Nothing to report?
Anybody want to adjourn the meeting?
So moved.
Second?
Third. Motion's approved.
Go ahead.